A beautiful morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this unique and first time ever one-day conference on technology, the Technology Summit. Well, the purpose behind organizing this conference is to elevate, transcend each one of us from just a professional CA to a truly digital and professional CA. Bangalore branch of SIRC of ICI is organizing this one-day conference with the intention of disseminating knowledge on the various offerings of information technology, be it artificial intelligence, data analytics, cybersecurity, etc. On this note, I request the chairman of Bangalore branch, CA Pamparna, to kindly welcome and escort the chief guest of the inaugural session, Ms. Deepa Sheshadri, director with Deloitte, along with the conference coordinator, CA Rafiq. I now request the chairman of Bangalore branch, CA Pamparna, to present the welcome address.
Dignitaries on the dais, of the dais, invitees, dear professional friends, ladies and gentlemen, a very pleasant and happy morning to each one of you. I'm very glad to be amongst all of you, witnessing this overwhelming response by our members to attend this first ever technology summit with the theme Adopting Disruptive Digital Technologies, CA Leading the Change. I appreciate all the participants for having shown keen interest to learn and update the lead the change. This is the first time we are having, and we got a very good response from all the members, and see further henceforth we see that this will be an annual feature from the Bangalore branch to have a every year technology summit, because we got a very good response from the members from industry and as well as a practice. The emergency of information technology has very significant impact on all the activities related to accounting profession. In this shifting world of information technology, we CA should have thorough understanding of IT as a key enabler, controller, controlling the various business processes and controls. We all should know the business processes automation through software applications. If we are unaware of the emerging concepts in the field of IT, like virtualization, grid computing, and cloud computing, etc., we are nowhere. Therefore, in order to march towards an excellence, safeguarding the interest of our profession and service, we should find the time to learn to update ourselves. Hence, these kind of summits, conferences, seminars are being organized, and we have to make use of this opportunity for get benefited. Dear friends, we have with us Ms. Deepa Sheshadri, Director, Enterprise Risk Service with Deloitte, as a keynote speaker to inaugurate this summit and deliver keynote address. On behalf of Bangalore branch of SIRC of ICI and all of us present here, I extend very warm welcome to Ms. Deepa Sheshadri. I request CA Divya to come forward and present a welcome bouquet to. Friends, when I contacted CA Rafiq, to be coordinator for this one-day technology summit, he has readily agreed and taken the so much of efforts and taken a coordinate to program this beyond the imagination. On behalf of all of us present here, I wholeheartedly welcome him for this conference summit. He is an instrumental in coordinating all the speakers and sending communications, mails to all the members, and advertise about this technology summit, and we have achieved more than overwhelming response, and we have achieved the target. And thank you for Rafiq sir, your kind support for us. And now I request BT Shetty to come forward and welcome him for this technology summit. I am very proud to say our eminent speakers, CA Babu Jayendran, CA Anand P. Jengad, and E. Narasimhan, E. Vital Raj, CA Guru Prasad, CA Ajay Gupta, CA BP Sachin Kumar, leading exponents of technology, will provide us valuable insights on the emerging digital scenarios. We all know that most of the enterprise processes are now automated. The latest development in the information technology are through business automation, which is used across the world. After a few years without office automation, the profitability and future viability of the enterprises increasingly depend on the continued functioning of office automation, cloud computing, etc. Hence, we all should know that more about advanced information technology to improve our business, ultimately paving the way to economic well-being of our great India. We assure that these deliberations during this summit will be have great value addition to each one of us. Coming to upcoming programs to the Bangalore branch, we, since implementation of GST, we have organized an 8-day workshop on GST from 16 to 25th January. It's already closed, the registration has been closed, where we have taken 100 participants, where we are intensely training workshop on GST. And we have one more program, important program for the young members. We have a one-day seminar on GST, office management and practice development and strategies for young CS, where more useful topic for the youngsters who want to set up their practice. We are having one-day seminar on this, and members can pass on the message to our youngsters. Who are below 30, we are charging only 300 for one-day seminar, and for a seniors, we are charging 600 rupees. This is on 27th January. And coming to sports activity, we Bangalore branch is the first time we are organizing a national badminton championship on 27th and 28th. I request all the members to take this as also make use of this this thing. And I request once again, I welcome you, each one of you, for this technology summit and make use of this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Pampana, for welcoming the gathering. I now request CA Rafiq to present the overview of the summit.
Good morning. Hello. Be a little more excited. Good morning. That's great. They say one of the best blessings you can get is may you live in interesting times. And if you look at the times now, we are not only living in interesting times, we are living in exciting times, we are living in challenging times. Now it all depends on whether you are able to identify these opportunities and change orbits. And technology is one platform which actually helps you change orbits. India is supposed to be the digital power and is expected to rule the world in the digital economy. Long back we had colonization. If you don't use this opportunity, we will get into what is called as digital colonization. And all of us chartered accountants are supposed to have intellectual power. Now we need to blend this intellectual power with the technology power to ensure that we are able to take India as the emerging or the leading economy of the world. We know that there is a digital disruption and it's happening in a very big way. Wherever you go, you find technology making a big impact in diverse ways. And you don't even know how it's impacting because the change is happening so suddenly, so immediately, you don't even know the impact. And there are new business models which are emerging, which are completely overshadowing the past. There are new paradigms in which the way the business are done. You have organizations which don't own assets, but just by a digital platform which they have, like the Oolas and the Ubers and the, Ubers and the Amazons, they're able to create a new industry, a new business, a new set of customers. What they have is not a large infrastructure. What they have is the information systems which can actually connect the customer to the supplier, which they can connect the service provider to the service user. See, the old paradigm of how business is being done is completely getting changed. And that's where we need to recognize this opportunity. How audit was done has to rapidly change, has to radically transform because of the technology transformation which is happening in India. We know that digital is not only now, it is going to be the future. So it's important that we identify what are the tremendous technology opportunities which are open to us and see that we are able to encash it. For the first time, we are seeing the government is pushing technology in a very big way. So we accept or not, they say technology is like a river. Unless you are on it, you will be under it. We know the impact of demonetization. We also know that GST is going to come. We know all the initiatives are taken by the government is toward making India a digital power. Because the government has recognized that if India has to stand out as a leading economy in the world, we have to ride this digital power. And this is the digital revolution, and India has to become a significant player in this digital revolution. With this objective in mind, when we designed the summit, we said we'll focus primarily on chartered accountants, and we'll see how best we can provide insights to chartered accountants on the existing and emerging technology and how it will impact chartered accountants, so that you can take new insights and perspectives, understand the power of technology, and see that you're able to harness this power for the use of your own office and also in your clients. The speakers were selected based on their practical experience. So you'll have a blend of speakers who are vastly experienced and also young. But among all the presentations, you'll also find there is a common theme. The idea is, when I wanted to have this technology summit, we said ideally it should be 2 days. And when I talked to some of our traditional chartered accountants, they said 2 days technology yaru barala. So we said we have to restrict it. So what we did was we tried to package these 2 days in 1 day. And that's how this. So this technology summit is more like a one-day match. Not only one-day match, it's a 20-hour match. So the pace is going to be very fast. What I want you to do is be alert. Identify what are the opportunities. Don't look at only collecting information, collect insights. Look at how you can practically use this idea. We have speakers who actually use this technology. So you can also touch base with them and get in touch with them and see how you can apply this technology. So there is a common theme which is there across this summit. And this is what I want you to keep. These are the questions I want to keep in mind. What does technology do and how is it evolving? What is the impact on the enterprises and professionals? Can chartered accountants be at the leading edge of technology, not be the bleeding edge of technology? And as CAs, how can we leverage technology to provide existing services and also new services? And as CAs, how can we prepare and update? Not necessarily from a technology perspective, from a technology deployment perspective, so that we can provide business value to the clients. This summit has been designed to provide you an overview from the top, and this is what we will give you, a view from the summit so that you can view across the horizons of what technology is emerging and what is available now, so that you can chart your destination of how you want to carve out your own future. So if you look at the details of the topic, this is how the summit has been designed. You'll have the keynote presentation. We will talk about robotics, how robotics can be used for audit. So it could be possible in the near future we'll have drones going and do the physical inspection. Okay, so we look at whether it's possible. Then we'll get into artificial intelligence. We know human intelligence is the ultimate. And as long as computers were designed to do what they were expected to do, that is very simple. Now you find computers have learned one human quality, and that is learnability. And if that is where artificial intelligence comes in. And if you can harness this power of artificial intelligence of computers, and you can make a tremendous impact. Then we'll get into data analytics. After that, we'll have practical application of technology in a CS office. And then we'll get into specific areas pertaining to how do you use mobile apps and social media as a chartered accountant. Then we'll get into mobile applications for chartered accountants, especially in a digital economy, because most of the commerce happens in transactions. And if these transactions are available digitally, what is going to impact? How as auditors we need to audit? Because the need for audit will never change, will always be there. How you audit will always have to change. And we know, finally, this digital information has to be protected, and that's where we have digital security. And at the end, we have a panel discussion. We'll talk about what are the emerging technology frontier challenges and what are the possible solutions. So hindsight, they say, is history. What is required, especially in the digital age, is that you need to have insights. You should be able to provide insights to the clients, and this is where we can use technology power to actually help India to take the lead in the digital age. There was an old paradigm which talked about the auditor, and traditionally you talk about rules. The auditor wants to ensure that he followed the rules and ensured the client followed the rules. But there's a new paradigm, and that's what Ron Weber said about 2 decades back. But he said to be a good auditor, you have to be better at the business of the client than the client himself. And that is the expectation. When the digital information is moving much more than the speed of thought, as auditors, can you help the client to navigate this information highway? Can you provide a consultancy or advisory services to the business as required, using the digital power? And this is where they say, either we innovate or we become irrelevant. So what we'll be doing will still continue to exist, but that has become more and more reduced. This technology summit, I hope all of us will have a great learning experience, and we should be able to transition
from ideas to action. So before I conclude, I want to give you, take you to a particular situation. Long back, there was a battlefield of Kurukshetra, and Arjuna became despondent and laid down his arms and said, I cannot fight, because he became very emotional and he found he was fighting with his own masters and seniors. At that time, there was one person who gave him advice, Krishna. And then long, far away, there was one person, Sanjay, who was actually explaining what happened in the battlefield to the king, Dhritarashtra. Now look at the situation. There are three listeners and two speakers. The first speaker is Krishna, and the listener is Arjuna. The second speaker is Sanjaya, and the listener is Dhritarashtra. Now look at what is happening here. You have Dhritarashtra, who is listening to the advice of Krishna, but he is listening to this from the perspective of fear. He is saying, why is he unnecessarily forcing Arjuna to fight? I think unnecessarily he is making this battle very bloody for this one. Okay. Now look at Sanjaya. You are receiving the information, but you are not analyzing this information. You are only transmitting the information to Dhritarashtra. And then we had Arjuna, who was receiving this information. You are receiving this information from a particular perspective that you wanted to absorb and implement. Now you have a choice. What are the type of listener you are going to be? Are you going to be Dhritarashtra? Are you going to be Sanjaya? Or are you going to be the Krishna? Are you going to be the Arjuna? I am sure all of you are going to be the Arjuna. We'll understand, get the insights and implement it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rafiq, for giving an overview. Let me now take this opportunity to introduce to you very briefly the keynote address speaker. Ms. Deepa Sheshadri is a director with a leading consulting firm, and she's associated with the Enterprise Risk Services division of that firm for over 19 years. She has done a postgraduate diploma in business administration and is a certified information system auditor as well as a certified information security manager by qualification. She has led a number of controls assurance engagements, both on process and IT controls. She has been involved in third-party risk assessments, security review, infrastructure review, and various technical environments. She has been involved in a number of offshore development reviews as well. And she also brings in rich experience in serving manufacturing, automotive, IT clients. She's a regular faculty in the ISACA chapter and has published articles in the ISACA journal and leading newspapers. With this introduction, I welcome Deepa Sheshadri once again to the gathering. I now request the dignitaries on the dais to inaugurate the summit by lighting the lamp. I also request the managing committee members of Bangalore branch to join us. Sheshadri to present her keynote address on robotic business, audit process automation, emerging trends and impact on CAs. Over to you.
Mr. Rafiq and ICAI to have invited me for this technology summit. What we'll be talking about today for a brief 15-20 minutes, and then we would also have some interactions in terms of the what is robotic process automation all about. You know, when I started reading about robotic process automation, when someone told me RPA, I thought robots are going to go all around the room for me to do the processing, right? Unless I went inside and looked at it to see that, you know, there's nothing visible at all. It's all small software programs that's going to be running to do certain set of activities. So we will go in and see in detail in terms of what is RPA all about. And we will also touch upon in terms of if you're doing an audit in a company which has implemented RPA, what are the key things as auditors that we will need to do? That's number one. And the second one, how can RPA help us in doing audit in a more efficient manner, right? So those are the key things that we will be covering in today's session. We will also have a couple of videos that is generally available for us to really relate to this particular topic in terms of the RPA. So that's what we will be looking at today. Today, whenever we talk about processes, technology, one of the key processes that comes in everyone's mind is finance. And the financial function is going into a very lot of changes are happening to the finance function. A lot of transformations are happening. So one of the key things that are happening from a finance perspective or the finance function perspective is in terms of the robotic process automation. This is very common. This is something that's really happening in shared services or the GICs as we call. What is RPA all about is to making sure that repetitive tasks are done by not by people but by a set of commands or a set of set of programs that will help you to do things much faster. The second thing that we are looking at is in terms of cognitive computing or you know what we call as machine learning, saying that based on certain trends that is happening, can someone make decisions or help you to enable making decisions, right? So for example, if we talk about cognitive computing, and the next slide I'll be also talking about intelligence automation as well. So what does this mean? Like, you know, what do I mean by machine learning? If we have a small kid at home, right? What do we tell the kid? That there are certain things that we say, if you do this, I will give you a reward, I'll give you a chocolate. But if you do this, you're going to get a punishment, right? We keep emphasizing the same thing to the kid so that the kid learns and say that, okay, this particular behavior will give me a chocolate, right? And this particular behavior, I will be penalized for that. So we build algorithms in the in the programs which can help you in the same behavior to making better decisions or to come up with certain outcomes. The third part of it is automation. One of the key things whenever as auditors you go in for any particular audits, you always tell the clients always say that you know everything is automated, right? Most of my processes are automated, so please look at the system and derive do your audit through the system. There are a lot of automations that are happening, and as auditors, we should be able to upskill ourselves to meet the requirements from an industry perspective, right? At the same time, there are certain enablers that will help you from a finance function perspective. One, we've always been talking about the cloud platform, where enabling automation through a cloud platform, you don't have information available at the client locations, but it is hosted on certain cloud through which you're going to be accessing information and you'll be looking at it. The people within the organization also have to have certain expertise for you to look at this digital transformation that is currently available. Of the collaboration that needs to happen between the technology team as well as the finance team. So all of this is something that we see that is happening in today's digital world from a finance transformation perspective. So what are the different type of automation that we are talking about, right? So first one is the RPA or the robotic process automation. This is very simple. I will also show you a video in terms of what is RPA. We always talk about an elephant, so we'll see what this elephant is all about. There are certain repetitive tasks which will be done by certain programs. right? So the auditor's capabilities in an environment which has RPA should also be little different from what we are doing today. So we'll touch upon this in today's discussion. There are two other things that we are looking at. One is the intelligence automation, and the other one is the cognitive intelligence. Now, the auditor, the way the auditor's function will change will be in these two areas in terms of introducing intelligent automation and cognitive intelligence in the entire process. I can give you an example of cognitive intelligence. In some time back, you would have read in the papers that Google went around in their van taking pictures of all the streets, all the localities across the world to put all the details into their Google Maps. Have you heard that? Right? So now what they did, the easiest part for them was to go around the city to take pictures. Right? And they had all the pictures, they had the street numbers on that particular the picture. Now how do I translate all this particular information into my into the program for it to read automatically saying this particular picture means this is the street, right? So what they did, they had millions of pictures that they had with them. So what they did, they used the cognitive intelligence. For 100 of the pictures, what they did, they took the pictures and identified a trend, saying if suppose a street number will start with so and so. So what they did, they started circling, saying all these things will generally mean street number. Okay? They did it for 100 of their pictures that they had taken. They uploaded this in this particular software. The other millions of records, they just scanned it. The system within 2 hours were able to look at that particular picture and then identify this is the street name. Right? Now what happens? Does this mean the entire exercise is fault proof? No. So what will happen is someone had to look at the exceptions. There could be certain things that the particular program was unable to read, which would go and put it in an exception kind of a box. Right? So someone had to go into the exception box and look at which are the ones that it has rejected, the reason for the same, and then only look at that set of exceptions and move it back so that the entire process is read, right? So they use cognitive intelligence in that particular manner for them to upload all the details in terms of a readable format. As soon as you key in certain data, you get where you have to go. IBM Watson is another product that is available. We always thought lawyers cannot use RPA. Okay, or lawyers have so much to read, there is so much of interpretations to do for me to get certain outcomes, right? That was what we had traditionally thought. But IBM Watson as a product, what it can do is, based on the case studies that are already available, that is fed into that particular software, right? Now what the tool does is, in case you give a particular scenario, right, from a lawyer's perspective, it will go and match similar cases that are available and then tell you that these are the three opinions that can come up. You decide which is the best one. Again, this is not going to say that lawyers, for example, are not going to be available, but it's going to bring down, saying it's going to make it more effective to say that out of the entire, based on this particular case history, these are the three options that are available. Now you as a lawyer decide which is the best one that you can do it. The same kind of things is can be used for your tax audits in terms of contract compliance related work. There are tools that are available which has cognitive intelligence in, which will help auditors to do the entire process much more effectively. Artificial intelligence is also there, and some part of artificial intelligence is used in some of these automation as well. But to my knowledge, it's more a kind of a black, it's still in paper, it's yet to come in terms of the entire process, especially from an audit perspective. So in today's session, we will look more in terms of what RPA is, right? So as I've been saying, RPA is nothing but certain robots, or they call it as bots. Bots that will be available on your computer. When you program it in such a way, it will do certain transactions in a much faster and efficient way. Now let me show you a video. We've been talking about RPA. I'll show you a small video in terms of what we are talking about.
Automation and robotics in manufacturing work for some time already. Transferring that to business processes is called robotic process automation. What does it look like? Large organizations are usually following very complex processes. They carry with them a wide variety of systems, some of them new, some of them are legacy heritage. Some work is just copy-pasting of data or synchronizing multiple systems when it comes to back-office processes, for example. With robotic process automation, we can train the business people to very easily automate dull and repetitive processes so the people have more time for added value work. In this case, software robot is working through remote desktop in SAP, Excel, and a client's web application. It uses standard human user interface, it navigates itself through the menus, and it clicks on the same buttons and resolves the same error and info messages as a human would. Benefits of robotic process automation are huge. We move repetitive work to robots and keep consistent quality. We save money as robots are less expensive and they work 24/7. And you can scale number of robots in a matter of minutes. Robot work is logged and traceable to tiniest detail. It's secure and fast.
So we just saw a robot in action in terms of how it's able to go and pick up certain data and doing certain transactions in an ERP such as SAP. So what are the key benefits of RPA? After seeing this video, I was just wondering in my house if I have some kind of a tool that can just by a click of it can do my repetitive tasks. That would have been wonderful. Or from an audit perspective, one of the key things that I personally like, doing a report or something where all the information is available, somebody can just click this button and just give me a good report. That would be something I thought would be very, very beneficial. Right. So what are the key things that we are looking at from an RPA? Is RPA going to be replacing humans? The answer is no. Right? We are going to be using our own resources in a more effective way. We all have talent shortages that is there. So what we are trying to do is use that particular talent in much better processes rather than doing repetitive job. So that's the main theme behind RPA. Right? So what is we saw an RPA in action. So what are the key things that it can do, right? It can. I'll give you an example of an invoice processing in a shared services, right? So what happens? This particular shared services receives invoices from various customers, right? Or from the various vendors. So once the vendor sends that particular invoice, it will be to a particular mailbox. So what happens? The individual opens that the email. He goes and checks what is the invoice, right? And based on the invoice, he goes, picks up that invoice, put it in a particular folder, right? And then he opens that particular ERP. Let's take it's an SAP or Oracle. He will open that. He will put the invoice number. He'll go and check what is the vendor code, what is the invoice number. He will put that to see whether the purchase order was there, whether the goods have received. If it is there, he will go and process. He will go enter those details into that particular ERP. And then he will press a button in which it will say, I have processed the invoice. Correct? And then it will send a confirmation back to the vendor saying your invoice is under processing. Right? This is a typical thing, simple operations that gets done in a particular shared center kind of an operation. Now what an RPA, so what are the various steps that individual is performing? The individual is opening an email, he's logging into an enterprise level application, he's moving files, folders, right? He's looking at certain fields, verifying certain fields before he passes that particular transaction. And then he's going to again send back to, he's going to give a confirmation saying this activity is closed, right? So this is a repetitive task an invoice processing person has to do. Now the bot that is available can automate this entire process to go ahead and reduce the kind of work that that particular person is currently doing. So that is what an RPA can do, and we have seen a small demo to introduce on the RPA. As that particular video also mentioned, RPA has always been there in manufacturing companies. There's a large manufacturing companies to see the ship movement, they're using robotic automation to kind of check where the ship movement is, etc. So in the manufacturing setup, robotics was always in action, right? There are many manufacturing companies where you do not find anybody at all. It's just there is only one shop floor person who does, by a click of button, he's able to manage a lot of things. Now the same concept is also being introduced from a process perspective, from a financial process perspective, right? Now when we look at some of the facts about robots, right? We'll also look at robotic process automation as well as intelligent automation. Where auditors are going to benefit from their own audit purposes is from an intelligent automation and cognitive technology. So that's where the audit function is going to benefit very, very hugely from this particular topic, right? So when we see the few differences between the robotic process automation and intelligent automation, the first thing is automation tasks that are in an RPA, it is more of a methodological, repetitive, rule-based things can be configured from an RPA perspective. Whereas in an intelligent automation, you can also do non-routine, recurring or thoughtful consideration, right? We have a tool that is available for reading contracts. So what this particular tool does is you can upload all the contracts into this particular tool. It will go automatically read the contract and will say, let's take limitation of liability is one of the clauses that are there. It can go and read all the 1,000 contracts and make a dashboard and say which are the contracts which has unlimited liability, which are the contracts that has liability to the amount of fee that you receive or 1.5 times that fee, or what is the jurisdiction in which that particular contract is supposed to be. So it can also do non-routine transactions, and the way the contract is structured will be very different. You're not going to have a standard contract term. You may or may not have a standard contract. Or the optical character recognition softwares that are there also fall as part of the intelligent automation, where it can go read certain trends and do it. But on another hand, RPA will be a very structured data that it will look at. So the RPA will be able to follow instructions. So there is some saying that please do these 5 activities, RPA will go ahead and do it. And that's what it will do. Whereas in intelligent automation, it can come to a conclusion also, saying, okay, if this is the scenario, this is the outcome that has to come. So that is the second difference that we will be looking at. The application is broader, can automate any suitable process, whereas an intelligent automation can become narrower. Applicable application should be targeted to deliver meaningful and insightful output, right? So that's the difference. You will have to use intelligent automation and cognitive technology in a specific manner, right? Market offerings it's maturing, and RPA is maturing, and in terms of intelligent automation it is emerging, right? And in terms of implementation time frame, it will take weeks to implement an RPA, whereas it might take months to do an intelligent automation, right? So these are some of the differences between the RPA and intelligent automation. Some of the myths, I've touched few of them to say that robots will replace humans. That's again a myth. It's not going to replace, it's going to help humans to do much better tasks, better thoughtful processes rather than repetitive. RPA software robots are 100% accurate. It will be 100% accurate provided you are configuring it in a right manner. Otherwise, it's like, you know, you do a wrong configuration, then it's going to give you wrong results, which you're going to be finding it very difficult to go and trace. Right? RPA marks the end of business process outsourcing. Are the answer again, because all these bots are going to be sitting in, are all our BPOs going to shut down shop? The answer is again no. Right? It's going to enable them to be more efficient, more scalable, more in the sense of meeting expectations from their clients and giving them more confidence. Right? And the cost benefit in the first year of implementation of RPA, there might be a cost that you will be incurring, but over a period of time, the cost will kind of even out. So these are some of the myths about RPA. There is another demo. I'm not sure how much time I have. If I complete faster, I will come back to this particular demo. This is just what I had explained to you in terms of how an email is opened and how it picks up the data and does a lot of stuff, right? So we'll come back to this demo after my session is towards the close. So as part of the RPA, there are certain key elements that you will need to look at. One is the process developer, right? So all we are talking about is certain automation that is happening. So there is something called the process developer who will give the instructions for that particular robot or the bot to do certain transactions. So that is the process developer. The second person will be the robot controller, is used to assign jobs to robots and to monitor their activities. So if you see in all of these, it's important to know humans are involved. It's not that once a bot is implemented in your laptop, everything is going to happen automatically. It will happen, but there are certain connects and very, very important connects at an input stage which all of us need to be aware of. The third point is each robot is located on a client environment. Okay, so it can run on from certain desktops. It can run certain processes to complete their transactions, right? And there will be business users who have to review, right? Again, once the robot the bot has completed its transaction, there will be certain exceptions, and those exceptions have to be again reviewed by the business owners. Robots are capable of interacting with wide range of applications. So in the first demo that I had shown, there were various applications that were there. So an RPA is not going to kind of make any changes to your, it's not going to make any significant changes to your technology environment. It's whatever human was doing, it's going to do similar thing. It's going to be integrated as part of your process. Right? Now the most important thing, let's take a client has, one of our clients have implemented RPA. So what are the key issues that your key risks that you see from an audit perspective, right? There are going to be new risks that are going to be emerging, and Mr. Rafiq in his introductory note also mentioned there are a lot of automation, a lot of things that are happening because of which we need to upskill, there are new risks emerging. So from an RPA perspective, what would be the key risk that we would be looking at? One of the key things, like today, if you're a statutory auditor, you're doing you're an internal financial control, you're doing an IFC related work, what do? You do a walkthrough. You sit with a person and he explains to you how the invoice is coming and how the processing is happening. Right? In an RPA kind of an environment, there's nothing going to be physical, right? It's all going to be happening at the background. So the way you're going to be doing your walkthrough is going to be challenged. The second thing, the timing of involvement. After an RPA is implemented, you go as auditor and tell them, I want to audit, right? But the entire process is already been set. So the auditor has to make sure that he gets involved right at the time when the RPA implementation is going on or when the configuration is happening. The third one. One of the key things that we talk today is segregation of duties, right? We always talk, this is one of the key risks that all of us as auditors point out from a statutory audit perspective or from your different type of bank audits, etc. Now, there's going to be a new paradigm towards SOD because there are no people. There are user IDs that are available, and that user ID is passing particular transaction end to end, right from vendor creation to making a payment. Right, the entire cycle is going to be done by that particular ID. So there's going to be a new paradigm that we're going to be looking at in terms of an SOD. The other risk is, as I had said, By a click of a button, we spoke about speed, right? So in case there is any logical flaw or an error that is there in configuring the RPA, then all records will go wrong. That's the, we always know, when we do it with lot of speed, it's very difficult for us to go and track where the errors are. So that is one of the key things that you will need to be mindful when in an RPA kind of environment. The other one is in terms of cyber threats, right? Now you have user ID passwords, so the passwords are going to be stored in a common place when you look at the RPA. Someone goes and hacks that particular password, right? Then your entire system is open, right? So there are going to be new cyber threats that are going to be coming in, and your IT audit will play an important role in that, right? The other important thing when you look at RPA is exception handling, right? So I, as I said earlier in my introduction, is in an RPA, it is not that you will be looking at all the transactions, but you will be looking at exceptions that the RPA is throwing about. So your audit focuses will be more in terms of looking at audit logs, etc., rather than looking at from a transaction perspective, right? We always have a lot of HR related risks that we are talking about. Let me take an example again from a BPO perspective. If I have colleagues here from the BPO industry, or if you are an auditor going to a BPO industry, the amount of background checks that you have to do, right? Some companies say you have to do a drug test and a lot of background verification. Now the bots are going to be there, so there's not going to be any background checks that you need to do on the bots. Right? So the whole paradigm in terms of your HR related risk is going to be a little different than what it is today. Physical access controls, if you are from the IT, ITS background, the number of ODCs that you have, biometric access that you have to get into a particular facility, those things will again be changing because there's not going to be too many physical security measures that you might need throughout your facility. It might be restricted to your data center, etc. Right? The other one is you have to look at challenges around machine learning. Right? As I said, are you telling your kid the right thing? Right? Are you telling your kid the right thing for him to get a reward, or are you teaching him wrong things? Right? We always look right whenever my kid. In fact, give instruction to my daughter, I'm always on the phone, I'm telling her something, right? Whenever you see her playing, when I see my daughter playing with her friends, she also does that. She look at some, she has a toy phone, she look at it and she'll be giving instruction to her friend. So that means I'm not giving her the right message to say that whenever you're talking to somebody, please look at them and talk. Don't keep looking at your laptop or your phone to see what mail is coming. Okay, so if you are going to be configuring things wrongly, the results will also be incorrect. In terms of, from an auditor perspective, as auditors, as chartered accountants, what are the key things that I will need to look at? My focus on physical security, HR related controls from an internal control perspective might come down, but my it will be more towards operations in terms of backup, data center, network, cyber related thing. It will be more in terms of how the logic has been built, how the configurations have been done. That will be the more focus area rather than your traditional areas, right? Now, but will my total audit approach change? It will not. You will still have planning, you will still have walkthrough, evaluation, operating effectiveness, etc. The entire audit cycle will still remain, but the way you would be doing it will be different. So you will move from an outcome-based audit to an input-based. So that will be the major change that you will be looking at. Whatever you have configured, have you configured correctly? And if you've done it, and if you've taken controls in a correct manner from an input perspective, obviously your output will be fine. And please remember, exception handling will be one of the key things that you will need to keep in mind. Now, from an audit perspective, this is something that has been developing. As I had said, for our own audits, we use a tool. It's an internal tool that we use for contract compliance. That's something that I've explained. So it can do a lot of things. It can just tell you by if I put 100 contracts into that particular software, it give me an output. I just have to look at that output, and I do not have to read all my 100 contracts. So that is the kind of efficiency that whole tool is, the RPA is bringing with cognitive intelligence, that's bringing into my audit process. So a few things that I would like to mention from that perspective is that, one, you have to look at it more, not just outcome, you'll have to make it more from an input perspective. Just don't look at reports that are coming out, look at exceptions that are coming out. What are the benefits that you would get? I can just do a 100% audit, right? I can say, look at all contracts and tell me what are the various risks that are there, right? So it'll enable me to get a 100% comfort rather than sampling that all of us might be doing today. Third one, the third important thing is in terms of risk identification, right? If I have to do, let's take an audit, a statutory audit of a manufacturing company. If I just have our tools like RPA, I can just say, okay, look at the financial statements of about 5 manufacturing company, an IT company of this size. Tell me what are the 5 important risks that will be there. RPA with cognitive intelligence will be able to do that. So the auditors, as I mentioned, humans will still be there, but your focus of time will be in much better activities than the routine activities that is currently there. So these are some of the key benefits that RPA can bring into our own audit process, be it IT income tax related audits, statutory audits, IT audits. It will be something that will be helpful. So in summary, what are the key things that chartered accountants, what are the key things that any auditor needs to keep in mind? One, we will need to understand that we will need to unlearn some bit of things that we have already gathered, and we'll have to make sure that we learn new skill sets, right? So we will need to have our focuses more in terms of logical security, more towards looking at more of lot of IT related controls rather than many of the manual controls that we are looking at. So auditors need to look at new areas in terms of logical access, controls over cyber security, whether the configurations are done correctly, whether the scripts that is written is that correct. Interfacing controls will be very, very important. In a kind of a bank kind of an environment, they at least have 20 applications in the banks. So I need to see whether the interface, the bots have been configured to making sure that my interfaces are fine. So that's something that I'll need to do. Audit trails is very important, but in our scenario, very sadly, many people don't even configure audit trails. So if they do the same thing with the RPA, then we will have a huge challenge. Right? Cloud computing and cloud-based application, those risks will continue to be there that we will need to look at, and we will need to audit around machine language. Are you giving instructions? Has that bot been given instructions correctly to making sure it gives you the correct results and you're not just going and confusing the entire process? So with this, I would say that RPA, cognitive intelligence are here to help all of us, both for doing our audits, as well as in case we are doing audits on an RPA environment, we just need to upskill ourselves and making sure that we kind of make best use of the technologies that are available to making sure that we give better trust and confidence to the clients who look at us as auditors. So with this, I would like to conclude from my side. I'm open to questions.
Thank you, Ms. Deepa Sheshadri, for sharing your knowledge on RPA, robotic process automation, and also sharing with us how the RPA is evolving and emerging and being adopted by organizations, primarily for achieving efficiency as well as cost reduction. On that note, I would like to wholeheartedly thank you for having spent your time visiting us to address the delegates. I request the Vice Chairperson of Bangalore Branch to kindly present a memento as a token of appreciation. Like our Chairman Pampana mentioned in his welcome address, the backbone of this one-day summit, be it in terms of identifying the speakers and designing the topics, is Mr. Rafi. As a token of appreciation, we would like to thank him also, and I request sir to kindly come forward and receive a token of appreciation, a memento from Shivram Bhatt, the treasurer of Bangalore branch. A round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, to the efforts by Rafi.